My name is Alice Stevens. I am the widow of Robert Thomas Stevens. He was my husband for 52 years. He was born in White Plains, New York, was a White Plains police officer for 1 year. There he decided he wanted to join the New York City Police Department. He first was assigned to the 3-4 precinct, which was a very active had at that time a lot of crime, a lot of street fighting. He was actually shot there. His partner was severely paralyzed on one side. He became a sergeant after that. He was assigned to the 2-5 precinct, which was in Harlem. At that time, I asked him, gosh, what is it like to work in Harlem? And he said, actually, it's not too difficult, because so many people have moved out of Harlem because of all the crime. And he said, I don't know how anyone ever gets out of there and aspires to anything better. It's so difficult for those people. And I knew there were a lot of African Americans in Harlem, and I thought, you know, I really know nothing about them. I am a nurse, and I took care of a lot of people who are African-American, but I didn't know anything about their background. And that spurred me on to go to college, where I majored in Black Studies, and it was really the highlight of my life. I had a better understanding of my husband's job and the workings of a policeman in Harlem.
Do you remember any sort of, specific cases or stories?
I remember one specifically.
Somebody had broken into a convent and two men, and they attacked a nun and they beat her within an inch of her life. They carved 27 crosses into her. They raped her. I didn't even know what that was when I was a kid. And they just left her for dead. And it was on all the news. And when you grow up in a Catholic school, every day you had to pray for the health of the nun. And I was at my grandmother's house and the phone rang. And my grandmother screamed. I never heard my grandmother scream before. And she turned to all of us and said, your dad caught the guy who raped the nun. And so that was just an affirmation that my dad was Superman. The other weird thing, thinking that man was a monster, was that there was a movie out at the time called The Elephant Man. Elephant Man was this horrible, disfigured monster wearing a bag over his head with an eye ripped out. When they had the perp walk, which is what you do to show the press from the front door of the precinct to a car so they can take pictures of him, there's a guy with a bag over his head with an eye ripped out. And I just imagined what monster could be underneath that thing, what horrible, terrible human being did my father catch.
They had the help of the Chicago Police Department. Bo Deal, who was a very famous New York City policeman who worked under my husband. And
what did Pa think of Bo Deal?
He thought Bo Deal was a dynamic policeman, always on the go.
Hey, Bo, what's up? It's me. What's going on? I'm at a payphone. What's going on?
Listen to me carefully, please.
Bo Deal was in his anti-crime unit.
Okay.
A lot of people, my father was the sergeant of the anti-crime unit. And a lot of people don't know what anti-crime means. They think all police officers are anti-crime, which of course they are, but there's different divisions of homicide or auto theft or sex crimes or narcotics. And there's anti-crime, which is dealing with burglaries or armed robberies, strong arm robberies, muggings, things like that. Yeah, my father used to say two things about Bo Deal. He said he was the strongest man he ever met. He could do handstand push-ups. He also said that he always wanted to get the bad guy. There's a lot of people say a lot of things about Bo, he said, but he always wanted to get the bad guy. Odd things like he was driving down the street one day in the squad car, and he looked up at a building, and there was a coffin sticking out of a fifth-story window. And he said to himself, well, that's not right. And he went upstairs with his partner and opened the door, and there were stacks and stacks of newspapers to the ceiling, one of those people who are hoarders. And he walked in and he smelled this funny smell, which smelled like gasoline. And he realized he was standing in a pool of gasoline. And a wild-looking man came out from behind all of these stacks of papers, lit a match, and threw it at my father's feet. And it went into the puddle of gasoline and went out. Well, my father was a police officer from 1965 to 1985 in Harlem. So that was a time that was pretty dynamic. The city changed, the country changed. It was really a very dramatic time for New York City and for Harlem.
All right, Popeye's here.
My father had details with Popeye Doyle. He had details with Serpico.
Hey! I'm a police officer! Get over there! Hey! It's me, Serpico!
There was a lot of, he was at the Columbia protests at the Columbia University undercover. His former partner was at the Audubon Ballroom when Malcolm X was shot. He was at both the 1968 and 1977 blackouts, which was just absolute bedlam. He was at a time where the city was in budgetary restraints to where they weren't hiring anybody. They were laying people off, they had no money.
He was very proud to be a New York City policeman. He gave it his all when the blackout occurred. He just got in his car and drove down there. There was no hesitation on his part.
There were sanitation strikes, so there was just piles and piles of garbage. My father was shot at what is known to be or suspected to be a member of the Black Liberation Army, which was a militant offshoot of the Black Panthers. People protesting in the streets, terrorists from Puerto Rico blowing up places, the Weather Underground, as well as Black Panthers who were killing police officers, no matter what race they were. And it was growing, and it was getting more dangerous, it was getting more drugs, it was getting more crime, it was getting more filthy.
Whores, skunk pussies, buggers, queens, fairies, dopers, junkies, sick, venal. Someday a real rain will come and wash all this scum off the streets.
The thing too about when he was a police officer was, do you remember any specific instance where you felt nervous for him?
Yes, after he was shot at. He was traumatized by that, certainly. I asked him about it, and he said, all you see, and they had turned out all the lights in the basement, the culprit. He said, all you see is fire coming out of the barrel of a gun. Hmm. And because he was taller than his partner, he held the door of the elevator, and the partner stepped out first. That's why he was shot. My husband went after him, and the guy was climbing over the fence. And then he heard a shot, and it was his partner calling him back by shooting his gun. And he said, don't let me die here. Get me out of this rat hole.
I remember he was happy about retiring. You would ask him, do you miss the job? And he would say, no. Crack was just beginning. And he's glad that he got out of that so he didn't get caught in that mess, because it got even worse once he left the job. So he was happy about leaving, and he liked semi-retirement. I mean, he worked still in security, but my father was very handy, so there was a lot of things around the house. Actually looked forward to, he wouldn't say so, but it was landscaping and building and fixing and painting and anything house needed, so it was a lot of that.
What about the Mets?
Oh, the Mets, my gosh. He was, especially remember the 69.
What about in 86?
In 86, we were screaming. You probably have heard us at the stadium screaming, and it was great, great fun to be a Met fan.
Oh, yeah. I could talk about that for another hour. The New York Mets, I was born in 71, so I had never seen the Mets win a World Series. And that's the only one I have. I remember every pitch. I remember everything about it. 7 games, the precipice of loss after a great season.
Little roller up along first. Behind the bag! It gets through Buckner! Here comes Knight, and the Mets win it! Got it!
The miracle of a game or of a series or of a team could possibly have, it was a miracle. It was an absolute miracle that they won. Pa knew that too.
So you're a filmmaker. What did Pa think of that and your like aspiration?
Well, growing up, my father ruined a lot of movies for me. Not in a bad way, but in a learning way. My father would watch, say, a Western. He would be into it, and he would say, "Oh, look how perfect her skin is. Look how brightly lit that cabin is. Look how perfect her hair is." Those people would be leather-skinned. If they had teeth, they would be brown and rotted. They would be, you know, filthy. They were living in dirt places. It kind of forced you to say, this is completely unrealistic. And if my father really liked a movie, it had to hit home that it was realistic. So all these cop movies, all these ridiculous things that people get shot and they just move on ahead, and these ridiculous fights where people getting knocked out with a karate chop to the side of it was eye-rolling time for my dad. It made me be very sensitive to you can't pull that stuff off. That's ridiculous. For an audience to buy something, you have to make it very sincere and very real.
You might want to know how I met him.
Okay, how did you meet Robert Stevens?
Robert Stevens was a patient of mine when I was a student nurse, and of course I had to call him Mr. Stevens, and we had very strict guidelines then in 1958 that you did not familiarize yourself with a patient at all. But he was so good looking, and the youngest patient I think I ever took care of. He was 23, and he asked me if I would go out with him, and I said, "Oh, all right." And that was how we met and married.
In preparation for this documentary, my mother and I went through many old photos of Pa, some of which I didn't even know existed. What I saw was that he was a good lap to sit on, lay on, and cry on. That's me proving that I was never always 6'5". But one picture stood out. This is a photo of Pa at probably 16 with two guys and two girls on Jones Beach. Not only did I have a similar day with my friends last summer, but he looks just like me. I might not look like him when I'm older, probably not. But if I'm anything like him as a person, I think I'll be all right.
Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream. Do 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 shaboom. Life could be a dream. Shaboom. If I could take you up in paradise up above. Shaboom. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream. Sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and open, we'll meet again. Boom. Ding dong, ding dong, a lang, a lang, a lang. Oh, 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 flip, a bib, a rob, a dib. Oh, life could be a dream. If only all my precious plans would come true. If you would let me spend my whole life loving you. Life would be a dream, sweetheart.
Every time I look at you, something is on my mind. If you do what I want you to, maybe we'd be so fine.
Life could be a dream. Shaboom, if I could take you up in paradise up above. Shaboom, then tell me, darling, I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream. Sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and hope we'll meet again. Boom, boom, boom. Ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a